Hey guys, welcome to another episode of Adulting with Mr. Welch. This is actually a follow-up or a second part of a three-part series on repairing some sheetrock in my basement. Bear with me a little bit. This video is going to have a lot of pauses. I mean, you probably won't notice it, but you'll see me cut in and out as we go through different phases. So what we want to be able to do now, we want to be able to seal the seams, okay? And so we've got tape. Now, normally I would use the paper tape. It's pretty much close to the color of drywall anyway, and it's very flat, easy to work with. The only problem I'm dealing with right now is I don't have any sitting around my house. I do have this green drywall tape that it's actually used for like bathroom installations. Anytime there's a lot of moisture, it works well at both sealing the gap, but also creating a waterproof, or not a waterproof, but something that's not going to mold. Gets wet. That paper that we traditionally use, if it's going to be in a place that's wet a lot, there's a good chance it could mold or mildew. And so we don't want that to happen. Now, normally we just throw a quick layer of mud on and start going. I'm going to do that a little bit later, but I have a different issue here. Because of the fact that of where I am and of the fact that I had to create that stud there, the wall right next to this seam here is actually sticking out pretty far relative to my piece of sheetrock. Now, as I come further to the left, it becomes less of an issue. I could just throw a slather of mud on there and then slowly try to build it up. I'm actually going to first sand this off just a little bit. I'll basically take the paint and then like a layer of the mud that's been applied in the past, the texturing. I'm going to go ahead and sand that off, give myself a little closer edge to hopefully match up a little bit better. That's just me trying to make the best out of kind of an awkward situation. And so that being said, we're going to go ahead and pause the camera while I do some of that sanding. I'm just going to use a basic palm sander here. Now, you can use just a sanding block or sanding paper. It's going to take a little while to do that, and so I'm going to choose to just jump ahead with the power sander. It's also a good opportunity to sand off stickers if you're sitting on the walls that just don't seem to want to come off. Have any kids or roommate who can't seem to stop putting stickers on the wall, that's a good way to get involved there. All right, guys, we'll be right back with you. So a couple of things to kind of keep in mind. While I was sanding, because I'm in a place that's already a finished basement, I didn't want to get a ton of dust everywhere. I took into my vacuum and followed the sander to try and suck up some of the dust that was going to come out in the process. So that was another tool that's helpful along the way. Now, it's not perfectly flush. It's never going to be. I just wanted to take that edge off so that I have a little bit smoother transition. I'm going to use mud to kind of smooth all that out and cover it all up. I keep using the word mud. You can find it in buckets like this. You can find smaller amounts as well, but I always think it's good to have some around. This is an unopened container. I ended up buying too much last time I used some, but I figured I know I'd use it eventually. This is that opportunity to get it to good work. Don't expect it to stay good forever. It will dry out. But this is it's also called joint compound, but I've never heard an actual construction person call it that. Always heard it called mud. And what we're going to do is we're going to actually water this down a little bit. I'm a believer that when it comes to getting tape to lay flat, you're definitely going to want a little bit runnier consistency, kind of like pudding. This is a little too thick right now. That being said, where I'm not using traditional tape, I'm using the mesh. I want to cover that mesh up. I don't want the shape of the mesh to stick out. And so I'm actually going to go ahead and run with it pretty thick. So let's if it's all ready and set to go. Okay, so what we're going to do now, I've got a little tray with some mud in it and a putty knife. Just for this first kind of application as we get going, we'll do a little more cleanup as we go. But one of the nice things about this type of tape is it is a little sticky on the back side. It makes it actually really easy to pre-apply. Normally with tape, you're gonna have to have the mud on the wall already, have a little layer, thin layer. But with this, I can actually stick it to the wall, go ahead and cut it, let it kind of sit there and get it all prepped up before I start slapping mud on. We'll just kind of go through again about half on each part. Where this has that smooth edge, you know, that difference between the two, where the two walls meet, probably going to lean a little heavy on the shallower side, on the side that's deeper into the wall. I don't want that edge to flip up, but nothing's perfect. I'm just going to keep coming along and cut these pieces here real quick. Using my box cutter, my razor knife to cut all these pieces down to size. Alright, stuck to the wall. I definitely don't want that pattern. You can kind of see here that little mesh pattern. I don't want that mesh pattern to show up on my wall, so I've got to put enough mud on here to really make sure that I don't have nasty mess left behind. Just kind of stirring that mud together. You can see it's kind of runny. Oops, you can't see that. Through my kit. Alright. What I'm going to do is I'm going to start pretty small, pretty thin. Just throwing a layer on and smoothing it out. Smoothing it out. Now remember, I've got that gap. This is going to take a few coats to get this to actually be the way that I'd like it to be. So I'm not slathering this on so tight and so thick that I'm not going to have to do it again. I'm going to have to do this more than once. That's okay. I'm going to also be able to sand some of the rough edges off when I get to that point. But for now, I just want to make sure that I'm able to get this first layer on here with the tape to make sure that it's got a chance to dry and blend into the wall. And like I said, we're going to do some texturing. That'll be video part 3. But, you know, initially we just need to get the mud on the wall to hold this tape here. Nothing perfect. Just making sure that we're not going to have this gap in our wall anymore. Trying to match it all up. I try really hard not to leave giant ridges anywhere because I'm going to have to, the more I leave behind that doesn't end up belonging there, the more I'm going to have to mess with it. Now, while you're doing this mudding for the tape, it's also a good opportunity to take some of that mud and go right over the top of the screw hole if you have any screw holes or nail holes left behind. Now, a lot of times we try to put them right on the edge so that we can cover them while we're covering the tape, but sometimes you can't quite get it that close, or you know, on a big sheet of plywood or sheet of sheetrock, you're going to need more than just screws around the edges. So you're going to have to do some in the middle anyway. You can kind of see I'm coming across the tape, making sure I got lots in there. Then I pull down along the length of the tape. Trying, you know, to make sure I've got it coming from every direction. I want to make sure I'm filling in all the gaps, all that kind of stuff. But yeah, I mean, this is what I do all the way around. Once it's all done, a first layer, I'm going to let this dry for a few hours. When it's dry to the touch, it's going to change color a little bit on you. It's going to turn chalky white. And then you can kind of come at it and hit it with another layer. Where this inner layer is sunken in a bit more than the outer layer, when it's all said and done, what I'm going to want to do is pull outward. Okay, pulling outward with my tape, with my mud, and then coming down along the edge. In the long run, make it so it doesn't show up as a divot in my wall. I'm going to use a much wider brow cutting knife. This is going to make it so that when I drag this across here in the long run, it's going to make that look so smooth and blended in that you're not going to be able to see the difference. But yeah, I'm going to apply a ton of mud to this section just because I want it to be nice and smooth and consistent. I'm going to do the best I can to match texture. I'm also going to come over the spots where maybe I've seen I have a hole in my wall, nail hole, cover a few of those up. I'm going to have to repaint some of the section anyway, and the bigger section that you repaint, more the paint's going to blend in with the old paint. So those are all things to kind of think about. Drywall repair should be a small drywall repair. You should always have a good amount to do. If you're doing a tiny little itty bitty thing, you're going to have a hard time blending it in perfectly. But take time, do it right, and we'll see you for part 3 when we do the texturing. All right, guys, good luck, and we'll see you around.